Hey, good morning, everyone. Good morning, Compass Church. Welcome, welcome. I love that there's just so much energy here today as we get ready to just sing our praises to the Lord and hear from the Word together. We're going to start off with some songs of worship. If you get the emails from Compass, the words were sent out this week, so you can check your email for that. Or if you want some printed copies of the words, they are over on this lovely table that you probably walked right past when you came in. So if you need to grab some words, grab them off that table or pull them up on your phone or device and you can follow along. And we're going to just worship the name of Jesus. So would you stand with me? About the victory that we have in Jesus Christ. We live in light of his resurrection. We live in the resurrection power of Jesus. And so we are victorious through him. So let's sing this together.
victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Amen. It does, doesn't it? Let's give him a praise.
My favorite things about the Lord is his faithfulness. That he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We can trust in his character. We can trust in his goodness and his love.
Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness. You have filled me with peace. Promises. And I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to
God's people said, amen. You may be seated.
Kelly! Woo-hoo!
Welcome to Compass Church. It was kind of interesting. Yeah, I told Kathy, I got to go to work today. And that's been kind of strange to think about, but I welcome myself for being here. And so also I'd like to welcome everybody online who's watching. My name's Kelly Jones. I am one of the pastors here at Compass Church. And, just want to thank all of you. And I just want, Kathy and I just want to thank all of you for your encouragement. I can't tell you what that means. I mean, coming back after being gone for 3 years, you just are kind of wondering, like, who remembers you? Who wants you to come back? Who doesn't want you to come back? And you kind of play all those mind games, and you guys have just been overwhelmingly encouraging. And so we just want to, you know, thank you for that. We still have the same connection card, so I feel really comfortable about that. And I think we have a couple billion of those left over, so we might have those for a couple more years. But anyway, if you're new today, we'd like to have you. Here's our table over here. We have connection cards. We'd love to have you fill one of those out, put it in the offering box right there. If you have a prayer request or something going on you want us to pray about or know about, you can fill that out and put it in there. And also, if you don't want to give today, that's our box to give to. If you want to give online, you can do that. And so we take all credit cards, Master, Visa, and all that. So that'd be good. And oh, yeah. There's water over there. You can get water and umbrellas. That's going on. And so that's really cool. You know, it's weird being here in one sense. I just have to admit that it's just kind of like I'm sitting here like this really did happen. And I could tell you a lot of stories, but the one thing I know for sure, Kathy and I will agree that, and we prayed over 3 years, like, God, what do you have for us? What do you want us to do? And all of that. And never did I ever pray, Lord, bring me back to Compass. That was never on my prayer list. Matter of fact, that was one of those things I never thought would happen. And then when it happened, I knew that it was God. Only God can do those kind of things. You know what I'm saying? Like, what you don't even think about praying for, God can pull it off. And so we're just so encouraged, you know, to be here. And, you know, with Matt and Truett, I told them, hey, the band's almost back together. And it's time to go on the reunion tour or whatever they call that. So anyway, let's pray together. And we'll pray for Matt this morning as he brings the word to us, that God would just speak through him. Father God, you are totally awesome. And in so many ways, we marvel at who you are. You have a sense of humor, and we know that by how you just work in our lives, and you do things for us that we never anticipated would ever happen. And so we give you all the praise and all the glory for that. We come to you as sinful people who have been redeemed. And we confess to you today that if there's anything that our church is involved in or that we're involved in, Lord, we confess that to you and seek your forgiveness and thank you for it. Lord, I just pray today that you would help us to be thankful. We are so thankful for this place to meet. We are thankful for our health. We are thankful to live where we live in a beautiful area of the country. And we're thankful that we have a church home that we can come to and be encouraged and be built up. And we are so thankful for that. And Lord, today we just pray for Matt as he steps up and brings the word, Lord, that you would fill him with your spirit. Lord, I pray that you would give him the boldness that comes through you, that he would speak your truth. Lord, I pray that any thought of what people might think would go out of his mind and only to please you would be in there. And so we anticipate, Lord, what you have for us. And we pray as Jesus said, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says. Amen.
Thank you, Kelly. Hey, good morning and welcome to Compass's outdoor service. We are psyched to have you here. Whether you are in person here joining us or you're joining us online, we're psyched to have you be a part of our Compass Church family. My name is Matt Collins and I'm also one of the pastors here at Compass. So don't worry about the cheers that you gave Kelly. I'm not jealous about that at all. So I'm just messing around. No, thank you for that though, really. I wanted to take a minute and just say that if you're here for the first time today or you're joining us online for the first time, we are especially psyched that you've chosen to join us because that's why the church exists, to allow us to be the hands and feet of those who bring good news to those who don't know. So we are excited that you're here, especially if you're a first-time guest, and you get to walk into this series with us as we continue our series called Unity, A Study in the Book of Ephesians. And we've looked at chapters 1 and 2 already, and now we're going to dive into the beginning of chapter 3. And if you ever want to check out some of our old sermons, you can do that either online at our website, that's compassbend.com, or our YouTube channel, which just go on to YouTube and search the Compass Church Bend channel. We did have some hiccups trying to get those uploaded, but they are all uploaded now. So go and check those out if you haven't seen them or you want to watch them again or you want to share them with some friends, you can do that. So those should be there. Please reach out to me and let me know if there's any problems with accessing those, because we want to make sure that those are accessible to not only the people that call Compass home, but the people that are searching for home and want to know what Compass Church is all about. So with that being said, let's go ahead and hop into our passage today. It's at the beginning of Ephesians chapter 3, and we'll see what God and the Holy Spirit has for us to hear as the body believers here at Compass Church. So we're going to read the first 13 chapters of Ephesians 3. If you have a hard Bible, like a physical pages, turn the pages Bible. Ephesians is all the way towards the end. And we're in chapter 3, which is in fact past chapter 2, before chapter 4. If you have an online Bible app on your smartphone or your tablet, go ahead and press Ephesians and get to chapter 3. And we'll go ahead and read this together. We're going to read all 13 verses first, and then we'll pray about what God and Holy Spirit have in store for us. So, starting at verse 1, it says, "For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles, surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. That is, the mystery made known to me by revelation, as I have already written briefly. In reading this, then, you will be able to understand my insight, Paul's insight, into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to people in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. This mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, the sharers together in the promise of Christ Jesus. Verse 7, I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Although I am less than the least of all God's people, this grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of Christ and to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden by God who created all things. His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to the eternal promise that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. Verse 12, in him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are your glory. Let's pray real quick. God, thank you so much for just using your Holy Spirit to put this on paper for us to read thousands of years after it was written. God, it's so important for us to know your intention of this church and your will for this church. Not just Compass Church, but also Big C Church, the global church, your followers all around the globe. God, I pray for your wisdom as we look into this. I pray for your Holy Spirit to just hit us in the heart and allow your Holy Spirit to speak through me and not allow these words to be my words, but to be your words. And for these convictions to not be convictions I give, but convictions that your Holy Spirit prompts us to have. God, thank you so much for this time. Thank you for this weather. And God, thank you for getting the wildfire that came yesterday out so quickly, Lord. We are so thankful for that. So thank you. And we lift this up in your name. Amen. When that fire came out yesterday around 5, I wondered to myself, what's this going to mean for tomorrow's service? I don't know. I don't know if the smoke will come in. I don't know. God, what's going on? And then it was out almost as quickly as it was lit. So God, thank you for that. All right, so as we look at this passage, as we start studying this passage, from the very first verse of this, we can see the setting of this letter. So it's widely believed that Paul wrote 4 of his epistles. Epistle is just the Greek word for saying letters to a group of people. 4 of his epistles while he was in prison. So there's 4 epistles that Paul wrote that are considered his prison epistles, his letters to church while he was in prison. And so, in this case, while he's writing this, along with Colossians, Philippians, and Philemon, Ephesians is penned while in prison. And so Paul is awaiting trial. He asked to be heard by the emperor, and he's awaiting to be heard by the emperor. If you want to read more about that, it's in Acts 28. So you can go ahead and look into that. But he's waiting in prison. He pens this letter to the Ephesian church. And in doing so, in this first verse, we see something special. So, of course, Paul, when he wrote this letter, didn't write this in chapters and verse numbers as we see it now. Those were added later. But up until now, most of this letter, which was just one big flowing letter on a scroll, up until now, most of what we hear from Paul is all about praise, prayer, and thanksgiving. All the while, Paul's got a Roman guard handcuffed to him just a couple feet away. And he's penning this. And when you look at verse 1, it says, for this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles. He doesn't say he's a prisoner of the Romans. He doesn't say that he's a prisoner because a lot of Jewish religious people were upset that he's sharing good news of hope and new beginnings to Gentiles. So even though he's sitting in prison and he sees the writing on the wall that this is probably close to the end of his life and his ministry, he has a firm belief. He maintains this firm belief that God's in control. And he says that I'm a prisoner of Christ Jesus for the sake of the Gentiles. I know why I'm here. And I'm not sorry about it. I'm not feeling bad about it. Don't you feel bad for me either, he finishes this passage with. But he just says, I'm here because I did the work of Jesus Christ. And I'm not apologetic about that at all. And so he maintains this firm belief that God's in control. And I read that and I think to myself, man, sometimes when I'm driving in the car behind someone that's driving 3 miles under the speed limit, I actually yell out the window up towards God and say, are you even in control? And here Paul is in prison wondering if he's going to live or die for what he's shared. And he knows God's in control. I think we can learn something from that. I think I can learn something from that for sure. But Paul knows, as he looks at his life and tries to reconcile the situation he's in with God's control, he sees no contradiction there. And sometimes in life, if I'm honest, sometimes in my own life, which is not anywhere close to the persecution that Paul faced, I have trouble connecting those and reconciling those. But Paul doesn't. And I think we can learn from that, that even in the worst situations, we know full well that God's in control of this world. And so even though there are things that happen that we might wonder why they happen, we still know that ultimately in the end, it's going to be for the glory of God. And Paul has no problem seeing that and knowing that. And then he continues in verse 2. Surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. That is, the mystery made known to me by revelation, by God himself, as I have already written briefly. In reading this, then, you will be able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to people in other generations, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to God's holy apostles and prophets. In verse 6, this mystery is that through the gospel, the Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members together of one body, the sharers together in the promise of Christ Jesus. God's will for Paul was that he could share the gospel specifically with a group of people that the gospel and God was never quite shared with in this way. And so that's God's will for his life. And it's important to look back to see where Paul came from, because that's important. And so we discussed Paul's kind of coming into ministry briefly week one. But just remember that when we first meet Paul, he's standing over a follower named Stephen, and he is approving of the stoning to death of this believer. It's Christianity's first martyr, and Paul is standing over, and he's approving of this. More than that, he goes off and asks for permission to go and find more followers of the way so he can do the same thing that they did to Stephen. And on the way, he is struck off his horse with a real-life encounter with Jesus, and it changes his life. And it turns him into being someone, rather than finding followers of the way to persecute them, finding people that aren't yet followers of the way to tell them the good news of Jesus, it totally changed his life. He grew up Jewish. He knew exactly what was going on from that perspective. He knew that the Old Testament prophesied a Messiah, and then he was coming up through Israel. And so as he went to these Gentiles, he knew exactly what the reaction would be from the religious elite, and he still went to it. And so, although the Gentile church was built mostly by Paul and through his missionary journeys, the first person to reach out to Gentiles wasn't actually Paul. It was Peter. Peter was the first one to reach out to a Gentile and share the hope and the good news with them. And we can read about it in Acts chapter 10, which is the chapter after Paul is knocked off his horse. And so when we read this in verses 9 through 23, let me just kind of give the setting here. A Roman centurion is a good man. He's God-fearing. The Jews love him. And he has this angel tell him that, hey, you need to go find this guy named Simon, they call Peter, and have him share some information with you. And so this centurion who's God-fearing says, okay, and he takes a couple of his servants and he sends them off to try to find Peter. And so that's where we pick up this story in verse 9 of Acts 10. It says, about noon the following day, as they, those servants, searching for Simon Peter, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up onto the roof to pray. I sometimes go onto my roof to pray. Sometimes I just go onto my roof to escape my crazy kids. But verse 10, he becomes hungry and wanted something to eat, and while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He has this vision. He saw heaven opened up and something like a large white sheet or large sheet being laid down to earth by its four corners. It contained all kinds of four-legged animals as well as reptiles and birds. Then a voice told him, get up, Peter, kill and eat. I wonder who said that. Peter replies, surely not, Lord. I have never eaten anything impure and unclean. So the Jews and the Jewish people of this time followed a lot of regulations, and they did things that were commanded by God, but they did things in a way to keep themselves pure and clean. And so he didn't want to defile himself. So he says, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to defile myself. And the voice speaks back to him in verse 15. I'm sorry, in verse 14. Peter says, surely not, Lord. I'm not eating anything impure or unclean. The voice speaks back to him in verse 15 and says, do not call anything impure that God has made clean. And so Peter's having this vision, and he says, that's unclean. And God says, no, it's not. I've made that clean. And so this happened three times, and that's significant. It happens three times, and I mean, it's significant that, you know, Peter denies Jesus three times, right? Peter, this same Peter is the one that Jesus asked, do you love me, three times. So this three times thing is common to Peter. I'm sure when he hears the second time, he's like, oh, it's going to be a third time too. Here it comes. And so this happened three times, and immediately the sheet was taken back up into heaven. And while Peter is sitting on the roof wondering about the meaning of this vision, the men sent by Cornelius, that's the Roman guard, the Roman centurion, these messengers found out where Simon's house was and stopped at the gate. They called out asking if Simon Peter was there. And while Peter was still thinking about this vision, wondering what this message is all about, I don't know if you're like me, sometimes a message might come and I'm like, what's that mean? But Peter keeps thinking about it. Sometimes I just dismiss it. But Peter keeps thinking about it. And these people come, and he's still thinking about this vision. The Spirit says to him, Simon, three men are looking for you. So get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them, for I have sent them. The Spirit says, I've sent these people. Do what they ask you to do. So Peter went downstairs and said to the men, I am the one you're looking for. Why have you come? And the men replied, we have come from Cornelius the centurion. He is a righteous and God-fearing man who is respected by all Jewish people. A holy angel told him to ask you to come to his house so that he could hear what you have to say. Then Peter invited the men in to the house to be his guests. And they leave tomorrow and go back to see Cornelius. And this is the first time that somebody is told by God to share this good news with a Gentile, a non-Jew. And so Peter, I'm sure, is having this inner fight. He's having this inner conflict because he's never really associated with non-Jews. And up to this point, even though the church is growing and it's a big movement that a lot of people are worried about that have power, all those people aren't Gentiles. The early church was a church filled by converted or completed Jews. And so this is the first time where Peter says, okay, what's this mean? I got to go to this Gentile and share the good news. And so Peter gets up and he follows this vision. This vision I also call the bacon vision, because it's where we are now allowed to eat bacon, which I am thankful for every day. But that wasn't the intent of this vision. This vision wasn't to tell Peter that when you look at these animals that you can eat them because I've made them clean. The intent of this vision was to say, you can go talk to Gentiles about the hope in Jesus because I can make them clean too. And so Peter goes and he follows his orders and he talks to Cornelius and shares the good news with him. And so Peter starts this movement, but then God picks Paul, who's pretty much a hero to rigid Jews and a villain to both new Christians and non-Jews, to be the main tool God's going to use to bring Gentiles into the family of God. I mean, it's this weird idea that you're going to take the most unlikely person and transform his life like this by throwing him off a horse, and all of a sudden, he's the main tool to build up the Gentile church. So these two churches kind of exist at the same time, and we have the church made up of converted or reformed or completed Jews, and then we have another church made up of Gentiles, and they kind of run parallel for a little while. And These parallels wasn't God's intention. And we heard that a few weeks ago when we heard that the wall of hostility was broken down by Jesus. And that wall ran through these two different types of churches. And we were supposed to bring these two churches together to be one church under God, one family. And so these Jews who were really upset that these Gentiles who didn't have to follow all these rules before they became followers of Jesus and filled the Holy Spirit had to kind of put down this idea and say, you know what? God's made them clean. They don't have to ceremonial clean themselves. They don't have to get circumcised. They don't have to follow these rules. They're just made clean by Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And so Paul comes on the scene, and he's the main mechanism that God uses to build the Gentile church. So let's circle back around to why Paul's in prison. So suddenly, all these people have been considered unclean and not worthy and filled with the Holy Spirit and hope, as are many of the Jews have come to believe in Jesus. They're all upset that these people can just come to Jesus as they are. There's a powerful song by David Crowder that's Come As You Are. And it's a powerful song. If you get a chance, look at that or listen to it. But so Paul is bringing this new group of people into the family of God. And many people are upset. So they go to the Roman authority and they say, hey, you should arrest this guy for treason and creating a rebellion. One of the things that the Romans did really well was squash rebellions. If somebody was even thinking about having rebellion, boom, they're squashed. And the Romans were really good at it. And actually, in the time of Jesus, there were all these small little rebellions, which is why some of the Roman leaders then were worried about Jesus and what he's doing. Is this going to be a rebellion? Am I going to be removed from power? And Paul's one of these people. They say he's causing a rebellion. He's treasonous. And so he's in jail. He's awaiting trial. But he's sharing Jesus with people. And so many people hated that. So I hope that sheds some light on what we talked about a few weeks ago with that wall of hostility and why it existed and it breaking through to be one church, one great body of believers between the Jewish believers and the Gentile church. And Jesus tore that down to come back as one. But that's why Paul is in this situation. Because not only did he build this Gentile church, but he was trying to get them to connect and get the Jewish church to connect as one body. So verse 7 and 8 continue with, I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power, of God's power. Although I am less than the least of all of God's people, this grace was given me to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches in Christ. Paul becomes a servant of the gospel. He becomes a prisoner of Christ Jesus by the gift of God's grace. When I think of being a prisoner or a servant, I don't think about it as being a gift of God's grace. But Paul here does. And then he calls himself the least of the Lord's people. Some even say the least of the saints. And it almost seems like Paul's got this false humility going on. I mean, this is Paul. He's written half of the New Testament by now. And so Paul's saying, I'm the least of these saints. I'm the least of God's people. But I don't think this is a false sense of humility. I really believe that Paul understood the grace that God gave him that changed his life from that road in Damascus to his three missionary journeys and in jail now. I think Paul really understood that. And I understand this from a personal perspective. Sometimes I have conversations with people and they're like, what do you do for work? And I'm like, I'm a pastor. And they go, nah. No, for real. Even people I grew up with, they're especially like, how the, we'll say heck, do you become, someone like you become a pastor? God's grace. God's grace. That's how I became in this position. I understood God's grace, and I still think of myself as not really worthy of getting up here and speaking the Bible to you guys, but I'm thankful every day that God's put me in this position. So I understand what Paul's talking about here. And I think there are really two major learnings we can learn from these two verses. And these two major learnings are, number one, sharing the gospel is a gift from God through the working of his power. Sharing the gospel is a gift from God. And believers are not only expected to make disciples and share the gospel. It's not to make converts, by the way, it's to make disciples. Let's be clear about that. It's not to share and leave. It's to share, baptize, and help build up. So we are called to make disciples. But we're also called to view that as a gift. I don't know about you, sometimes when I see an opportunity to share the gospel, I wonder, do I have the time or the energy to do this? And then I want to punch myself in the gut. It's a gift to share the gospel. I get to be in the esteemed position as a believer to share the good news of Jesus with someone who doesn't yet know it. It's a gift, and we have to know that as we look forward to sharing the gospel with people, it's a gift, not just a responsibility. And we can bask in that gift. And the second thing that I think we can learn from this is, if you're a believer and a follower of Jesus, you're a saint. You're called a saint, or the Lord's people. I think many people believe that a saint is someone who's sinless, or someone who's called a saint by some hierarchy of religion. Others can't get over the fact that they're a sinner saved by grace. Still others have no problem thinking themselves as saints, and I think we all know some of those people. But what I'm getting at is we have this question, and the question is, am I a sinner saved by grace as a believer, or am I a saint like the Bible calls me? You know what the answer is? Yes. You are a sinner saved by grace, but you're also a saint. You're made clean by God. And so you're set apart. You are a saint. And so as we look at this, if you're a follower, You are a sinner saved by grace, and you are a saint that is worthy of sharing the gospel with people. I think sometimes we wonder to ourselves, I'm not sure I'm worthy of sharing this gospel. I'm not sure I'm worthy of sharing this good news. The answer is yes. The answer is yes, you are worthy of sharing this good news. And you may not know the answers, but don't let that stop you from sharing the good news, because there are people you know that have some answers. There are ways you can find answers. It's right here. We know this. As we learn this, we know some of those answers to those tough questions. And so you are worthy of sharing the gift that is the gospel. And this continues in Ephesians 3, verse 9. It continues, "And to make plain to everyone the administration of this mystery, which for ages past has been kept hidden in God, who created all things." His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purposes that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. In him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. What a passage. We've heard Paul talk about the gospel as a mystery before, and I do believe that our idea of what a mystery is different than what Paul is talking about here in Ephesians. The Greek word used here for mystery is mysterio. And it's not something to be solved. In fact, it's something that can't possibly be known until it's revealed. So it's not something we can go out and just search the answer for. We have to wait for it to be revealed, and that's the word they use here. It's not mystery like unsolved mysteries, like, hey, I'm gonna show this show and put up a phone number so people can help me figure this out. It's, here's something that wasn't possibly known, but now has been revealed by God for us to know. And I think this is more like a secret than it is like a mystery that we think about. It's like a secret that was kept for so long. And now the secret can be revealed. Something that we could possibly not have known at that time, but was hinted at in the Old Testament as well, that the coming Messiah was coming through Israel, and he would save humanity. But the part of going to the Gentiles came across to even Jewish followers of Jesus as, what? Huh? And this is the mystery that Paul is talking about. But there's a question that I had here when I read this that I hope we all have here as well. And that is, why did God keep this a secret for so long? And this is some of the hard questions that you might receive as you start sharing some of this news. Like, hey, if this is such great news, why did God keep it a secret for so long? And I won't stand up here and give you some Christianese pat answer of, well, God's timing is perfect. Although I do believe that. I do believe that God's timing is perfect, but if I'm someone wondering about this, that answer does not satisfy me in the least bit. Because I'm not even sure if I believe in God. And you're telling me his timing is perfect. So something I'm not sure I believe in yet, you're telling me is perfect. I don't buy into that. So why did he wait so long? And I believe there's two reasons why it was kept a secret for so long. The first is to give Israel the opportunity to fulfill its God-given role, that the Messiah would rise up out of the people Israel as prophesied in the Old Testament. That's the mechanism through which Jews and Gentiles would be saved. So one reason is because Israel had to move forward to fulfill this prophecy. And the second reason is found right in verse 10. It says this, "His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realm." So, this blows my mind. The main way God chooses to spread the good news about the Messiah is through the church. It's through you. It's not just through pastors who come up with a microphone and talk. It's through you, the church. The wisdom is made known through you and through me because we are the church. Still getting used to that central bend humidity, or lack thereof. And then there's an even cooler part here about who it's being known, made known to. Yes, it's being known to unbelievers. That's absolutely true. But it says here also, it's being made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. Do you know what he's talking about here? He's talking about angels. He's talking about heavenly beings, created beings. And I know this sounds crazy, but one of the reasons God kept this Mysterio is to help educate the angels in heaven. Check this out. Angels are often misknown as these kind of mini God entities that walk around and do good deeds to earn their wings. That's kind of what we think about angels. Or even, you know, when we die, we become angels. And that's not true either. If you had that preschool theology, I apologize for popping that for you, especially if you're in preschool. Moving on. But angels are these created beings, and they're not created the same way we are. They're not created in the image and likeness of God. The Bible never says that. The Bible says humans are created in the image and likeness of God, but angels, we're not told that's the case. So angels are these created beings, which means they can learn, they can be taught, but because they're created, they're not like God. They don't know everything. They're not omniscient, omnipotent, or omnipresent. That's not who angels are. And so they learn, they can be taught, and in many cases, although angels can teach us a thing or two, this passage tells us that angels learn from the church, and one of their chief instructors is you. The angels learn from the church about how God works. That's crazy. I remember one mission trip that I took our youth group to. Actually, it was a trip that Caitlin was at. Caitlin's visiting us today, and she was actually on this trip. I don't know if she remembers the situation, but we had gone out into the Tenderloin District, San Francisco. That's where we went down to a place called City Impact. Every night we would do street ministry. We'd go out into the street, we'd be armed with food, and we'd start conversations with people. And the food was our tool in order to start conversations with people, just to get to know them, and if they allow us to, pray for them, and let them know that there is a church in the middle of the Tenderloin they can go to and hear more good news about Jesus Christ. And so the first couple nights we go out, we're not really comfortable like talking to strangers on the streets. But by the third and fourth night, we get more comfortable. And so I approach this one person and I say, "Hey, can I talk to you for a little bit? Do you want some chips?" We were giving out chips that night. "Do you want some chips?" And he says, "Yeah, sure." And we talk and I hear a little bit of his story. And then I say, "Can I pray for you?" And he says, "Okay." So I pray for him, and it wasn't anything memorable. I don't even remember what I prayed, but I remember this. When I was done praying, he said, "Can I now pray for you?" And I was like, "Sure, I'm down here with 17 high schoolers. I need all the prayer I can get." So he says yes, and I close my eyes, and he puts his hand on my arm, and it was like, in a weird way, the world changed, just in that moment. And he prayed for me. And he prayed so that I could stay strong in the mission that God has given me. And he used words that I didn't expect to hear. There's a lot of words that you hear from longtime believers, but I didn't expect to hear it from this person. I was judgmental, I admit it. I didn't expect to hear it from this person, but this prayer was powerful and it impacted me. And then he said amen, and I said amen. And he looked up at me and said, keep doing what you're doing. You're impacting the world in a way you don't understand. And they turn around and walk down Turk Street. And I was sitting there, I was like, wait, what just happened? I was out here trying to minister to somebody else, and this person who I don't know that looks homeless ministered to me. And suddenly Hebrews 13:2 popped into my mind. And Hebrews 13:2 says this: "Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it." Now, I don't know if he was an angel or not, but he was wearing a Red Sox shirt. That's irrelevant biblically, but I thought it was important. But his words were so powerful, and they kept me moving forward in ministry for a long time. And even when I was out of professional ministry, I was still doing ministry as much because of the words that he spoke into my life. And so we're surrounded by angels all the time, and although they intervene in the lives of the saints and the believers, they also get to learn from the church. They get to see how God works through a group of people. And they sit up there and they rejoice. And when we look at verse 10, it tells us the authorities and the rulers, some versions even say principalities in heaven, they watch the earth, the church, to see how God works through us. And I don't know about you, but if that doesn't get you stoked to be part of a church, I don't know what will. For me, reading that's like, you mean angels are watching me? Angels are watching you, and they're rejoicing in heaven over it because we're just following God and allowing God to work through us. 1 Peter 1:12 says this, "And now this good news has been announced to you by those who preached in the power of the Holy Spirit sent from heaven." So as you get filled up on Sunday mornings, you are to take it out and be the church throughout the week. "It is also wonderful that even the angels are eagerly watching these things happen." Angels are eagerly watching you. And they're celebrating. And they're psyched. And they're praising God of how he works in the church. If knowing that angels look down on this church and the way they do doesn't excite you, I just don't know what to say. Which is good, because I should really move on to verse 12. Verse 12 says this, "In him and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence." This is a great and really well-timed verse. Here's what it tells us. You should go out and share the gospel with the power that God has in you, because we can approach God with freedom and confidence through faith. Hey, how do I go and share the gospel? You share the gospel because you can approach God in faith with freedom and confidence. And we're reminded of what is written in Hebrews 4. Verse 16 says, "Let us approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." We can approach the throne of God. You can't stroll into the president's office. You can't stroll into the Oval Office and just talk to the president. But you can stroll into the presence of God, which is a much bigger deal. And I think sometimes we don't do that enough. The number one way that we can approach God while we walk on this earth is through prayer. We don't pray enough. I had a conversation just this morning about, hey, I don't think we pray enough. I was like, you're darn right, and just wait. The number one way we connect with God is through prayer. And we can connect with him with freedom and confidence and boldness. And those things are interconnected to faith. So as we have faith, we can have boldness. We have faith in Jesus, we can have boldness about approaching him. And we can be bold about sharing our faith. Because we can approach the throne. And so, if I was listening to the pastor the other day, and he said, if you spend less time in prayer than you do preparing and preaching, you're doing it wrong. If you spend less time in prayer than you do preparing your sermons and preaching, you're doing it wrong. And that's, I think we could apply that to any avenue of life. For me, it was a talk to pastors, but it convicted me. My goodness, am I spending enough time in prayer? Do I believe the power of prayer? And if I do, why am I not praying more? And so we can approach God through prayer. We can pray for a connection to God. We can pray to God for opportunities to receive the gift of sharing the gospel. We can pray for the seeds that we have planted. Listen, everyone you talk to about the gospel isn't going to get on their knees and accept Jesus right there. That's just a fact. But when you share the gospel, seeds are planted. And we can continue to pray for those seeds that are planted, so that at some point, maybe when we get to heaven, we see that person we shared with, and we think to ourselves, why? I didn't think you heard a word I said. And they said, I didn't really hear it. But it broke down that wall a little bit. And somebody later on said what you said, and I was in. So pray for those seeds. That's important. And I get asked all the time by people, how do I share my faith? How can I share my faith with people I don't know? That's a little bit easier than people I do know. Are you kidding me? I don't want to go up to my friends who know me and share my faith. That's scary. And I tell them I know. There's a couple things you can do, and I'd love to have conversations with every single person about that individually, but it's just really not that efficient. One of the reasons that I am excited to have Kelly Jones back on staff is because he ran and does these Compass U classes, and they are classes where you can come together and you can get some of these questions answered. One of them was, how do I share my faith? And so when you see these classes come up, sign up for it. You won't regret it. They are wonderful classes that he can give you real applicable information to live the Christian life out in a real way. So when you see those come along in emails, sign up for it. It's totally worth it. But so, when you're in there, you may be in there and like, Kelly's so wise, I feel like I want to turn off the faucet because it feels like I'm drinking from a fire hose. I don't think Kelly comes with a crank, though. So, but it's totally worth it. You will leave there, and you will think to yourself, why didn't I think of things that way? Because Kelly has a history of talking to people and getting different perspectives that he incorporates into his normal talk. And it's wonderful. So if you get an opportunity to go to that. Finally, let's look at verse 13. Because I've been talking far longer than I meant to. I apologize for that. But this is good stuff. So, verse 13 says, I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are your glory. Paul ends this the same way he begins it. He says, hey, I'm a prisoner, but don't feel bad for me. This was the intention. This is exactly how it had to happen. And so, Paul says to the Ephesians here, and to us at Compass Church 2,000 years later, almost 2,000 years later, I know that you could be discouraged by the position I'm in, but don't. Don't be discouraged. What I did to equip you with the ability to do great things. Remember, Jesus said, you're going to do greater things than I. Paul helped equip us to do that. And so Paul's saying, I've equipped you to go out and love people. I've equipped you to go out and share the good news of Jesus Christ. I've equipped you to approach God with confidence and freedom through faith. I've equipped you to do things that the angels can learn from. I've equipped you to be the church. Hey, Compass, let's take those words. Let's be the church that God's called us to be. Let me pray. God, thank you so much for today. Thank you for these super wise words, God. It's easy to dive into this and spend just hours wondering and dissecting these words that Paul wrote down. And they are so impactful for us as an individual believer, but even more so with us as a collection of believers, as a body of believers that call Compass home. We want to honor you because this is your church. And Lord, we want to be the church. We want to be the church that goes out and loves people. We want to be the church that goes out and shares the gospel. We want to be the church that boldly and confidently approach you. God, thank you so much for allowing us to be that. Thank you so much for your son coming down and dying so this could all be possible. Thank you for helping us understand this mysterio. God, allow us to be bold in our interactions this week, to see opportunities for the gift of sharing the gospel. And God, help us view it as a gift, not as a burden, not as an I don't have time to do this thing right now, but as a gift that you've given to us, this ability. God, thank you so much. We love you, and in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
What a powerful message from the Word of God today. So many incredibly applicable points in our lives. And I just wonder if during this time as we prepare to sing another song and just worship the Lord, that if each of us could just go ahead and just keep your head bowed and your eyes closed. Because I think that, you know, when we come to church, sometimes we are more spectators than participants. And I think that this is an incredible message with so many action points. So many things that we can take right now and today, tomorrow, this week, that we can do something different in our lives, right? This is an action kind of a message. So as you have just a moment with the Lord, I want you to just take a minute or two and just ask the Holy Spirit to speak to your heart what it is that He would have you do to step into action with this message today. Maybe there's a person or a group of people that you've been disconnected from because like Paul or like Peter, like the Apostle Peter, in the story with Cornelius, you just have been, there's just a dividing wall between you and someone else. And maybe that's your action step today, this week, is to break down that wall and reach out to that person. Extend forgiveness. Maybe it's your prayer life and you just are being convicted right now through the Holy Spirit that you need to set aside some time every single day to come into the presence of God with confidence and faith, trusting that He is going to answer those prayers. Maybe that's your action step today. Or maybe God is just speaking to your heart and saying, it's time to start sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. You've been doing the closet Christian thing, living for God when you're, you know, at church or with your Christian friends, but when it comes to actually sharing that with others, that's not really been something that you've been living out. Holy Spirit, would you just speak to our hearts and our minds? I know that you have something specific for every person that's here today. Thank you that you're moving and you're speaking. Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, peace, bring it all to peace. The storm surrounding me, let it break. At your name, still, call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every way. At your name, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, and breathe, breathe, call these bones to live, call these lungs to sing. Again, I will praise, breathe, call these bones to live, call these lungs to sing once again. Jesus, Jesus, your name. thank you, Lord, for that powerful name that we have been given. And it says in your word that there's no other name by which we may be saved but the name of Jesus Christ, because that is, you are the one, Jesus, who took on our sin, that took on our shame, that took on our burdens and nailed them to the cross. You took the penalty for that, for all those wrongdoings that we did. You paid that penalty once and for all. And so we stand victorious and free, in freedom and confidence, able to come into your throne room, God. I pray that we would know what a privilege that is. Just think of those in the Old Testament who didn't get to come into the presence of the Lord. They had to wait behind a curtain and wait for a priest to come out. And we don't have to do that. We get to come straight into the presence of God through the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you for giving us that freedom, that grace, that power. Your name is light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is life forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Sing his name. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, 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 Jesus. God, as we go from this place today, would you fill us with confidence and joy? God, that whether it's through a social media platform or a phone call or a text or an in-person conversation, God, that we would share your good news this week through our lives, through our love, through the way that we just interact with each other, God, that we would show people that there's something different. That when God, when people look at us, they would just see there's something different about that person, and they would want to know what it is. Why aren't you fearful? Why aren't you full of just this anger that's so prevalent in our world today? And we can say it's because of Jesus. He took that anger, he took that fear, and he nailed it to the cross, and I don't have to live in that place anymore. It's in that powerful, awesome name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Everybody said, amen. Well, as we close today, I wonder if there are some kids and youth who, I know Aubrey does. You don't ever have to ask that girl twice. They want to come up and help us with our last song, especially if you were at the camp out last weekend. We learned a song that had some motions to it, and we really need some helpers up here. So come on up. Don't be shy. I know Danny's hiding in the back somewhere. Yeah, I see you, girl. Come on, come on. Jamie, come on. Ah, yeah. Avery, yeah. Abby, come on, Abby.
We're calling you out.
I think I saw, did I see Ani somewhere? She's like, yeah, I'm hiding. Oh, there she is.
That's right. You guys can all stand right there. Go for it.
All right.
Stand in front of us.
So we're going to
go right there.
Yeah, just right here in the front. We're going to do Blessed Be the Name of the Lord, okay? So for those of you who weren't at camp or, you know, need a refresher course, okay? Blessed Be the Name of the Lord. We're going to just do a little side to side, yeah, right? A little gospel action. Then we've got the name of the Lord is, and we're going to point up to the Lord, a strong tower. Hillary, you want to come be a helper too?
Yeah,
you
sure
know you do.
Make sure
the righteous run into it. Into it, and they are
saved.
All right, kids know it. You guys can learn it from them. Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4. Blessed be the name of the Lord. us. Have an amazing week, everybody.
Blessings. Yeah.